Is a 400% return good? Well, this points to two often overlooked factors that are very important when considering performance of any asset. So the first would be duration, and the second would be utilizing an appropriate benchmark. So I think that for long-term investors, a decade ought to be where you start. So that's where a return starts to have meaning for long-term investors. When it comes to choosing a benchmark, that depends on what asset you've invested in. So when we go to answer the question, is 400% a good return for a decade? Well, we can compare that to the S&P 500, which has returned 177%. So if the stock that you're holding is part of the S&P 500, then you would say, well, I outperformed my benchmark. But if you then looked at NASDAQ, so there can actually be an overlap between the S&P 500 and NASDAQ, as we recently looked at in a piece. If your benchmark was QQQ, so that's the top 100 stocks in the NASDAQ, and you had used that as your benchmark and you were invested in Marvell, the ticker MRVL, then you wouldn't have outperformed the benchmark. You would have matched it. So you didn't do very good because you weren't compensated for the additional risk that you took for investing in a single stock as opposed to a broader index. So today we're going to talk about Marvell. They're talking a big AI game, and it's time we vetted that. So there's about $2 trillion of picks and shovels to be bought, according to at least one analyst firm. It's the amount of AI infrastructure CapEx expected to be invested by data center operators over the next 5 years. They asked the question, does the return on AI justify the cost? It's a great question to ask. And according to McKinsey, AI has the potential to generate $4.4 trillion in annual economic value. So if you spent $2 trillion and then once and then every year you generated $4.4 trillion, then it's certainly worth the investment. But we ask some questions here. Will there be a lot of money wasted from excess spending? Sure. Perhaps a peak of inflated expectations. You can say this time it's different, but those are four of the most dangerous words in investing. But when it comes to picks and shovels, the hardware still gets sold. And I think this Dilbert comic strip does a good job of explaining how everybody jumps on the bandwagon. So Dilbert's boss says, I think we should build a blockchain. And Dilbert says, whoa, does he understand what he said, or is it just something he saw in a trade magazine ad? So Dilbert asks him, what color do you want the blockchain? And his boss says, I think Mauve has the most RAM. So it's a great example of companies doing something because everybody else is. And when it comes to buying GPUs, a lot of firms are doing that. Here you can see this great chart from Omdia Research that shows just how many GPUs Meta and Microsoft purchased in 2023. And the question here is this: can we invest in the companies that sell equipment surrounding GPUs? So this goes back to the data center investment thesis, which we've been covering in numerous videos. So Microsoft and Meta, the companies purchasing the most GPUs, also happen to account for nearly 40% of Arista Networks' revenues. You see the piece we did here, 2,100% data stock. Now, that clearly outperformed its benchmark over the time that we measured it against. And then on the left, you can see the AI data centers piece. We looked at several ETFs that don't give you very good data center exposure, despite what they say on the tin. And then we looked at a research piece by Spear Invest that focused on data center stocks. And Arista and Marvell were two names they held that we hadn't covered. So we covered Arista. Now we're looking at Marvell. So this chart is very compelling. So it shows Arista's revenue growth over time. All right, so that's, and the top chart, that's compelling enough. But when we back out Microsoft and Meta, it becomes very interesting. So we see their revenue growth had stabilized over the past number of years and then spiked in 2023 by 41%. So that goes to show that there's true demand that's driving their growth based on the expansion of data centers. So before we get into talking about Marvell, I just wanted to point to our content. If you find it useful, you'll want more of it. And if you want to be notified when our new videos come out, click subscribe and choose to be notified. If you do that, that helps our channel. It helps boost our views and consequently helps the algo. So please do that. And then Wyatt's going to put a link to our free newsletter in the comment section. Please make sure to subscribe to that as well. So let's talk about Marvell's focus on data infrastructure. It's in four areas. The one we want to focus on is data center, but you also see carrier infrastructure or 5G there, automotive, which is another interesting area we've been looking at, and enterprise networking. Now, when you look at this chart here, when I first came across it, I was thinking to myself, wow, this might be a similar situation to how NVIDIA's data center segment evolved. Well, unfortunately, it's not. These increasing numbers, you see data center increasing from 33% of total revenues to 54% to 70% in their last quarter. But when you look at their last quarter, what actually happened is that their other segments just fell through the floor. Enterprise networking down year over year by close to 60%, carrier infrastructure down 75%, consumer down 70%. What's going on here? And this is why paying attention to quarter over quarter growth is important, because then look at those numbers. Something bad happened here. And when we look at the results for last year, their last fiscal year, some things stand out. So first of all, they talk about transforming into a leading data center company focused on accelerated infrastructure. We want to understand a little bit more what they mean by that. And then we see that their 2024 revenues, $5.5 billion, were actually down 7% year over year. That's not good. So we want to look at that. A company that's growing in a similar fashion to NVIDIA, and it's disrupting, doesn't have declining revenue growth. They talk about growing AI revenue to 10% of total company, and then they refer to data center revenue driven by AI. So seems like their data center revenue of $2.2 billion contains their AI revenue of $550 million. And this leads up to some questions. What do they mean by accelerated infrastructure? Why are revenues declining for other segments, and how temporary are those problems? And what's the difference between AI revenues and data center revenues? Well, when it comes to accelerated infrastructure, they show this chart here looking at compute, connectivity, and storage. And these basic elements of a data center should be intuitive to understand. And then we look at their solutions for each. Custom compute is one area that Marvell stands out in terms of their potential, and we'll talk about that. Now, when we look at the growth of these categories, especially you see custom compute there, where Marvell seems to have a advantage, then there's a lot of growth to be had between 2023 and 2028. And then they talk about expanding their share here, and that's something else that we need to consider when we're looking at any given company: is are they a market leader? Now, they have this chart in a rather verbose AI presentation they gave. It shows the accelerating AI revenue for Marvell, and that's great and all. But if it doesn't translate to top line growth, then it's pretty much just something, a decoration. So here they show where this coming year they should see a big boost from custom compute revenues, and that remains to be seen, of course. And then this category is something that they've just defined. It's not delineated in their financials, so it's just something that an internal number that the company produces. Again, we want to see top-line growth. And look at this for their last year. They actually saw a decline in data center revenue growth. And honestly, when reading their annual letter to shareholders and looking at their presentations, you wouldn't have thought this. They really don't address it. And I imagine it's just some of the problems surrounding inventory and the old macroeconomic headwinds. But they do provide some explanations for the dip in their other end markets like carrier and enterprise, reduced CapEx and spending, global slowdown in IT spending. That's an interesting comment. And of course, they expect demand to resume. But when you look at last quarter, this is quite remarkable. Look at the dramatic drop, at least in three of these segments. And they say that non-data center end markets are expected to bottom in the first half. Well, let's certainly hope so. That's rather a remarkable drop. And I suppose you just have to trust the messaging from the company's management team. Now, when we look at data center revenues, so going back to that chart we looked at where it said 88% year-over-year growth, well, look at what they're comparing Q1 2025 to. It's a low, an all-time low, at least on this chart. of Q1 2024. So that's a bit deceptive. That's where quarter-on-quarter growth might be more indicative of the opportunity, or even taking this to an annual level and then seeing that, in fact, in fiscal 2024, they saw a decline in data center revenues. Again, not something I saw them addressing in their commentary, at least what I looked through. Now, I came across this report from Fitch that's very useful. We used one in a previous presentation, and I just thought it contained a lot of good data. They talk about how they expect Marvell's strengthened technology and market positions will lead to positive revenue growth beyond nearer-term demand headwinds in non-data center markets, what we're seeing. And they refer to the inventory corrections weighing on revenue growth in fiscal 2025. So they're expecting that long-term growth in these other markets will be positive low to mid-single digits. So that's not overly exciting. But this comment here was interesting. Strong data center demand risks increasing customer concentration to the hyperscalers. Again, a situation like Arista had seen. But when we look at customer concentration risk for Marvell, we see, well, there's two customers that accounted for 26% of revenues, at least last quarter, and that's not nearly as bad as the situation over at Arista, nearly 40%. And then this distributor here is worth noting, but distributors we look at differently from customers. So when it comes to other comments that Fitch made, they say Marvell's, let's say, intellectual property supports its first or second share positions in its focus market, though it's principal competitor Broadcom, their larger scale may overshadow Marvell. So that's interesting. We did a recent piece on Broadcom that's worth watching. They talk about how Marvell's acquisitions have resulted in strong capabilities in accelerated infrastructure. Again, we see that term including optics and semi-custom solutions. So two areas where they say Marvell has significant opportunities in semi-custom solutions. That's an area then that if you were an investor in this company, you'd want to pay attention to. They say that overall revenue should decline by low single digits in fiscal 2025. So that's this year, with positive growth in data center offset by broad-based negative growth in all markets. So it's a case of the benefits from data center growth being diluted and muted, at least for next year, and it remains to be seen. They say broad-based recovery in fiscal 2026 next year result in positive revenue growth in the high single digits. So that's, we'd expect companies that are disrupting to at least be gaining in double digits, followed by mid-single digit positive growth. Well, of course, this is Fitch's estimates, but that doesn't sound overly compelling, to be honest. So just some concluding thoughts here. This is really a case of niche pure play exposure like Arista versus diversification across industries, as we see with Marvell. Market leadership is quite important. That's further elaborated upon in the Fitch report, certainly worth taking a look at that. We would probably just Google Fitch ratings and Marvell and look for any one of their more recent reports. You can compare this lack of growth at Marvell to what Arista is experiencing, even without their hyperscaler revenues, and just see the difference. The semi-custom solutions, those sound interesting in the context of every AI factory having its own custom chips. That's what Synopsys envisions, and certainly could be the future there. But we'd likely avoid this name, Marvell, in favor of names with top-line growth that already exists and that are benefiting strongly from the expansion of data centers. Now, I'm going to go ahead and leave you with another video. If you're somebody that's looking for the next NVIDIA, that's NVIDIA, now the largest company in the world. But there is potentially the other NVIDIA, as some have coined. So you'll want to definitely take a look at this piece next. Please make sure to subscribe to our channel and click notifications on to support our work. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this today.